Thank you. Please take a week to your seats and ready to make a noise to welcome the new flags.
Thank you. Well, welcome, the messengers of compassion. And we are so delighted that we can share this evening of celebration with you and that we can give with you thanks to God for that which he's doing in your lives, that which he has done and that which he's going to do in the days which lie ahead. As we stand, let us pray together. Gracious Lord, our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your call upon these men and women. Thank you, Lord, for the obedience that is evidenced in their lives as they have given themselves wholeheartedly, unreservedly to you. And as we have witnessed their ordination and commissioning this afternoon, and now as we come to this great moment of celebration, Father, would by your Holy Spirit, the enthusiasm, the joy, the happiness, the peace which has flown from this obedience flow into each of our hearts and lives. And that as a consequence of being together here tonight, there would be further transformation, marks of your compassion in our own hearts and lives. And we give you all the praise and glory in anticipation of that as we celebrate and as we give you praise. In Jesus' name, I ask. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Now, for the weary of you, you can be seated, but the others of us, we're going to remain standing because we're going to sing a song together. Oh, for a thousand tongues. And if it's more comfortable to be seated, of course be seated, but we're going to really express our thanks and our praise to God with the band helping us. Oh, for a thousand tongues. Let's sing together.
Oh,
be some people in this meeting especially who might identify with that. You need to know that God loves you and that he has a plan for your life and he wishes to walk your road with you. Love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. Thank you.
Oh,
It's on that great affirmation of faith. That compassion, the messengers of compassion, you are able to take hold of this commission and to go out into all the world as we all are able to do in his strength and in his power upon him and him alone. Please be seated. For those of you who are joining us today for the first time, we give you a special welcome today. I'm reminded that this afternoon we had an opportunity to express words of welcome to distinguished guests, not least of all our Chief of the Staff and Commissioner Bronwyn Buckingham, not least of all the international leaders from international headquarters, and most certainly General Brian Peddle. And for those of you who have just joined the meeting, it's not that I have a joke about the General, it's just that I acknowledge the General and Commissioner Peddle. I have to say that, you know, we're blessed to have international leaders such as these who choose to come. They ask, could we come? And who are we to say, no, you can't come? We're just blessed to know that our international leaders would feel they would love to be here. And because the General is here, I just would like to invite the General to the platform, because I thought it would be appropriate for him to say a few words. So please, would you welcome General Peddle? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Gracias.
I just want to shout out, God bless the United Kingdom with the Republic of Ireland. God bless the newest Salvation Army officers. Thank you. God bless you this evening. It's just a joy to be here. Commissioner is right. My daughter said, Dad, why are you going? You don't have anything to do. And I had to confess that I'm a commissioning junkie. We've just been a part of a commissioning in Indonesia at Jakarta. 32 lovely officers that have been sent into the world. And last weekend in Vancouver, another experience in my homeland of being a part of commissioning here. Can I just give a witness tonight that God is blessing the Salvation Army around the world? That God is blessing in the evidence of people just like these, because he doesn't call people to waste their lives. This is his mission in the world, and I'm absolutely excited to be a part of it. Glad to be here tonight, to have my entourage, and to be able to share together. I do want to commend to you Commissioners Anthony and Jill Cottrell as your territorial leaders. Pray for them and support them. I also want to acknowledge Captain Lee Graves and and Colonel Debbie Graves. We love these folks and their cabinet and their divisional team. They're leading up and down this country, and we want the Salvation Army in this land to be a God-honoring, strong army. This nation and the nations affiliated with it need the Salvation Army, need a blood-washed Salvation Army, need a baptized-by-love Salvation Army, and these folks want to lead that kind of army. So ready up, people. Join us in this incredible cause for Christ that we have in the world, that we have here in the United Kingdom with the Republic of Ireland. So I'm here under false pretense in this moment because I want to show you something. That's a very beautiful video that we want to use tonight to pay tribute to an incredible gentleman, Commissioner Harry Reid. Would you enjoy the video, please?
On D-Day 1944, over 18,000 men parachuted into Normandy, helping to turn the tide of the Second World War. One of the paratroopers was 20-year-old Harry Reid. Harry became a Salvation Army soldier at Edinburgh Gorgie Corps in 1946, and once demobbed from military service the following year, entered the International Training College. He was part of the King's Messenger session, where he and Winifred caught each other's eye. They married in 1950 and went on to have two children, John and Margaret. Harry and Wynne served around the UK from Eastbourne to southwest Scotland and as staff at the International Training College, where Harry wrote a number of songs for the annual commissioning of cadets. He became training principal in 1978. 3 years later, he was appointed as chief secretary in Canada and Bermuda, and then in 1984, territorial commander of Eastern Australia. It was there in 1987 that Harry received a phone call from General Eva Burrows asking him to take on a new role, British Commissioner.
This morning, a new commissioner, fresh from Australia, starts work with an evangelical mission in mind.
The greatest need is for evangelism. The best thing we can do for anyone is to bring that person into a good relationship with God. We haven't done our best for someone when we've given him a meal or a bed or counseled him about some marital problems, debts or whatever. We've done the very best for them when we've led them to God, led them to God through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Harry retired in 1990 with grandchildren and then great-grandchildren to keep him busy. In 2016, he was given France's top military accolade, the Chevalier, for his role in the D-Day landings. And Harry still had another jump left in him. As part of the 75th D-Day anniversary, he took to the skies once again, at the age of 95. He parachuted into Normandy to raise awareness of the Salvation Army's work to tackle human trafficking and modern slavery. And before heading home, he had an extraordinary meeting with Paul Goltz, a fellow D-Day veteran who was fighting for the Germans.
Once we were on a different side, But we are partners together in the rebuilding of the world.
We are friends.
We are more than that. We are more than that. We are brothers.
This man has been a leader in the Salvation Army longer than the majority of us have been alive. He's had one very special appointment, that was Canada and Bermuda territory. I was just a young officer at the time, but I recall very clearly Colonel Harry and Winifred Reed and their influence in that time. In recent years, you've been a bit of a problem for me. This is the first time that I can recall that an order of the founder has been influenced by social media and, in fact, that the pending recipient would have such an impact through social media. Commissioner, you probably don't know, but I have some social media presence, and all of your fans have been making suggestions to me. As if I can't make good decisions on my own. Commissioner, there is no way tonight that we could capture what you mean to us any more than we could capture the incredible influence you have had through your many years of faithful service. And the only thing that I can do tonight to somehow embody that respect and regard, which is well reflected in this particular congregation, is to issue to you the Order of the Founder. So the folks can hear clearly what you're going to take home, I want to share the citation. This Order of the Founder, as many will know, was instituted by minute dated 20 August 1917, presented tonight by the General to Commissioner Harry Reid. In recognition of a life of outstanding Christian witness in word, verse and deed, spanning 75 years with a recent and relevant witness through social media, captivating a global audience with the authentic message of reconciliation, hope, and peace. I hereby admit the said Commissioner Harry Reid to the Order of the Founder, and direct that his name be inscribed on the roll of the order, dated this sixth day of July in the year of our Lord, 2019. God bless Commissioner Harry Reid. Absolutely wonderful. Commissioner's going to have a word.
My third rib.
Yeah. Did you hear what he said? No, I'm not saying it. No way.
I suggested it might be my third rib. I'm left really not knowing what to say. I count it a very great privilege and honor to be made a member of the Order of the Founder. I've enjoyed life so much.
We're all envious, actually.
I've enjoyed life so much. I've lived a full life and a wonderful life. Yeah. And to be honored in this way is a very great honor indeed. And I'm grateful to you for it, and grateful for all the love and support that has come my way over recent years. I feel almost guilty about that jump, you know. I do, really. If the way of sacrifice is the way of sacrifice, I feel guilty because I enjoyed every minute of it. I thought it was brilliant from start to finish.
Excellent.
And since then, I've been saying, Harry, lad, you're enjoying this too much for it to be a life of sacrifice. But I'm grateful to you for the honor that you have afforded me. Thank you so very much indeed, Jim.
Ladies and gentlemen, Commissioner Harry Reid.
God bless you. You're deserving of this award. God bless you.
Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 12. How blessed is God, and what a blessing he is. He's the Father of our Master, Jesus Christ, and takes us to the high places of blessing in him. Long before he laid down earth's foundations, he had us in mind, had settled on us as the focus of his love, to be made whole and holy by his love. Long, long ago, he decided to adopt us into his family through Jesus Christ. What pleasure he took in planning this. He wanted us to enter into the celebration of his lavished gift-giving by the hand of his beloved Son. Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, his blood poured out on the altar of the cross, we're free people. Free of penalties and punishments chalked up by all our misdeeds. And not just barely free either, abundantly free. He thought of everything, provided for everything we could possibly need, letting us in on the plan he took such delight in making. He set it all out before us in Christ, a long-range plan in which everything would be brought together and summed up in him, everything in deepest heaven, everything on planet Earth. It's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, he had his eye on us, had designs on us for glorious living, part of the overall purpose he is working out in everything and everyone. Amen.
By Jesus Christ.
Would you like to see transformation in your life?
I want to lead a life devoted to scripture, prayer, and fellowship.
How is God calling you to show your devotion to him?
I am moved with compassion to meet people where they are.
Who or where is God moving you towards?
I am moved by Jesus' compassion for those who are left out. I was left out.
How are you moved by the compassion of Jesus?
I am called to listen to the unheard.
How do you listen to the unheard in your community?
I I was called out of my comfort zone so that he would be glorified.
What comfortable place is God calling you out of?
I am called to serve, no matter what the cost.
How is God calling you to serve today?
Today we celebrate the response of these people, these men and women, messengers of compassion to the calling of God on their lives. We celebrate the reality that God has a calling for each of his children. We're challenged by the call. We're compelled by the call. In a moment or two, we're going to stand together and respond to his call as we sing, O Church Arise. The last verse of this song begins with three simple words. Three words that make a fantastic, powerful prayer. So, Spirit, come. So, Spirit, come. Come to us as we stand together. Come to us personally. Come to us, call us, change us, lead us. Come to us, help me, help you, help each one of us to be all that God calls us to be and become. Let's stand and sing it and mean it and be ready to respond as the Spirit is at work in this place.
Thank you.
Living in college is quite good because, I mean, everyone's really nice.
It's a really nice community. It's a very sociable place. It's fun.
Some people call it William Booth College. It was made by Prince William.
Everyone's friendly.
Feels like there's always somebody near you that you can talk to.
A bit like adult school, but for people who want to worship God.
All day our parents are working in a classroom.
They've mainly been doing essays.
They're glued to their books.
They literally have to work almost all day.
Sometimes they like go to bed at like 1 o'clock because they've been working so hard.
They learn about the Bible and
They
know pretty much the Bible off by heart.
Like a real Salvation Army officer.
I think they've learned quite a bit.
And they know how to lead core worship on Sunday.
They go out as well to different churches and practice being a Salvation Army officer.
They sort of learn how to communicate with different people.
Yes.
My favourite bits are the canteen.
Yes.
And the hub. Because there's like free coffee machines.
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful.
I don't know how many hot chocolates or cream chops I've had over the course of the 2 years, but, you know, we don't talk about that.
There's fun activities for children here.
I like all of them. There's nothing I don't like.
Going to bed.
Yeah, that's not your favourite, is it?
Yes, it is.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh.
I like sleeping.
The Wi-Fi has been a little hit and miss, but other than that, it's been amazing.
We make some ice cream Play-Doh. And we make desserts.
Grapes.
I'll miss my house in the flat because I really like my house and there's lots of fun activities and memories.
I'm gonna miss Grace.
Yeah. Our quiz sessions in the hub.
Netflix.
Yeah.
Doing lots of work.
Yeah, we're like the very few teenagers that are here, so we stick together.
Yes.
I'll miss my friends.
I hope that my parents make friends at the new placements and that they do well.
And I hope she makes good progress.
I hope that they keep trusting that God is going to lead them.
I'd hope they enrich the area that they're being placed to.
Up there if you want to give them a little wave. I'm sure they'll wave back to you. We're going to sing again, so if you'd like to stand, it's Praise Is Rising.
Hope is stirring, hearts are
My journey to where I stand today has been marked by excitement and joy, by friends and family, by people who have sustained me on my way. It has also been marked by bad decisions, by regret, and by sadness. I imagine many of you have experienced those moments of laying down to sleep, only to replay all of your bad decisions and mistakes, the embarrassing moments you wish could have gone differently, all that great weight of guilt pressing down on you, feeling like you can barely breathe, barely move, barely live. Crushed beneath the pain and regret hanging around your neck, broken by the fear that everything will always be the same, dragged down by the difficulty of simply living every day. It is something I know well. But life doesn't have to stay like that. If you are bold enough, there is another way. There is a promise that all things can be made new. A promise of hope that is greater than all of the mistakes that I have ever made. A promise that I am loved, no matter who I am, no matter what I have done, no matter what I think about myself. This is the promise that I cling to when I think of what I'm entering into. A life spent adventuring, a life which brings God's loving transformation to this world. Officership is saying yes to one of the greatest lives possible. It is also saying yes to sleepless nights, carrying other people's pain, and trying to help people who don't know how to be helped. It is a life for which I frequently feel utterly inadequate. But in those moments, I know that despite my inadequacies, despite my failings and flaws, I am called to follow Christ. I can boldly follow Jesus only because I am not doing this on my own. If I had to do it on my own, out of my own resources, out of my own ability, then I would absolutely fail. Rather, I place my trust in the promises of Jesus. My weaknesses are carried up in God's own weaknesses, and I can follow where Christ is calling me to go, only because God has promised to always be with me. This is a promise for each and every person here today as well. Be bold and see where saying yes to Christ will take you.
My testimony is closely bound to the words of a beautiful song, Compelled by Love. It says, called to serve wherever there are souls in need, called to work where life is at its worst, called to follow Christ no matter where he leads. And in a world where it is easy to feel defeated, downcast, and insignificant, in a world where the easy and often recommended option is to look down and pass on by, I am called to a different course of action. I am called, compelled by Christ's love for me, to show his love and compassion to others. A love that is life-giving, life-transforming, and literally life-saving. I am called to invite people to find fullness of life in Jesus and, with the love and compassion of Jesus Christ, to care for the poor, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, love the unloved, and to befriend those who have no friends. I am called to be brave enough to get in there and take the field to care for those in need, to represent those who cannot speak for themselves, and to take Jesus Christ out into this hurting world and reclaim compassion in his name. But that calling is not for the faint of heart, and in many ways it is truly terrifying. To paraphrase Moses, Samuel, Mary, and a whole host of other called people in the Bible, I ask, why me? When God sent Moses to tell Pharaoh to let the Israelites go, to let my people go, Moses thought of several reasons why he was not the most able person to do this. But God promised Moses that he would be with him, that he would give him the words to say, that God would provide. And so Moses went. Well, this is my Moses moment. And I also choose to accept God's call, knowing that it is his will for me. Wherever that leads, or whatever that costs, I choose to go, to boldly go, because I know that God leads the way, and he will also be with me, that he will also give me the words to say. He is in control, and he will provide. Touched by God's grace, moved by God's grace, and filled with God's grace, today I step out boldly to do his work in the knowledge of the gracious, lavish gift of Jesus' love, which has the power to change lives. And in stepping out, I have no idea what awaits me, and I have no idea what I will face, but in his strength, compelled by his love, I will boldly go, and I will simply crack on.
Thank you. Wow. I was talking to Steve earlier, and just want to say thank you to the staff band. Steve told me this is his 43rd consecutive commissioning that he's been to. And he's only 37. I don't know how he managed it. Messengers of Compassion, if you forget everything else about this weekend, and you won't, remember that. Absolutely awesome. I'll not turn back, whatever it may cost. I'm called to live, to love, and save the lost. But I want to say to you that it's not just for the messengers of compassion, it's for us all. We're all invited, in fact, we're all instructed to keep going forward in the strength of the Lord, to keep going boldly. Reminds me too of one of Commissioner Harry's songs, which we heard in passing in the video earlier, prior to the Commissioner being admitted to the Order of the Founder, a song that the Commissioner has lived out and has encouraged us all to live out. The song which says, most of you will know it, "I dare to be different. I dare to live the life of faith, the life of challenge God has planned, of holiness and victory, for truth and righteousness to stand. I dare to ask the Spirit come to match with power my heart's desire, my life to cleanse and energize with mighty Pentecostal fire. I dare to want to live like Christ according to his will and way, his love to know, compassion share, and serve him boldly every day. You see, we're all called to go boldly, knowing his love, sharing his compassion. We're all invited into the journey of living like Christ in relationship with him, who, when we call upon him, when we seek his forgiveness for the things that separate us from him, you know, the sin that tangles us up and renders us powerless and inwardly lifeless, he graciously gives his Holy Spirit to live in us, transforming us, empowering us, enabling us to live out Christ-like lives. And when that happens, a little bit of heaven is released in and through us, ordinary people like us, a little bit of heaven released into our communities, into our families, into our workmates, into our neighbors, into our streets. My goodness, the world needs a bit of heaven. The presence of the glory, the radiance of God, and he wants to use you, all of us, to join in his shiny, redemptive, intentional acts of love and of grace and of compassion. All of us. I'm not sure if I should confess this publicly, and I've been in and out of this. Should I confess this publicly or not? There are going to be people who are going to be shocked and a little bit dismayed about what I'm going to confess to you in a moment or two. My credibility, such as it is on the line when I make this confession to you. I've been hooked on watching women's football. And what is really difficult for me to say is that it's because my first encounter with women's football was, well, kind of heavenly. You're laughing, you're shocked. But many of you have enjoyed watching the Scotland and the England teams in the World Cup. The divisional leaders from Wales have even enjoyed watching the USA play. But for Jill and I, we've actually attended an England game. Anyone else done that? Credit where credit is due. And not only that, it was an away game. Now you know I'm being serious. We woke up one Saturday morning in Copenhagen where we were stationed, and we needed something to do that day. And I turned on my iPad and looked at events in Copenhagen. And to my shock and utter surprise, that afternoon, Denmark were playing England in an international in their final warm-up game before the 2017 European Championships. And so we decided to go. There'd be plenty of room. We decided to go and we'll go and support the England team. So we went for the game. There were hundreds of people there. We queued up for quite a long time to get our tickets. In fact, I just got to the front of the queue to get my ticket, and I could hear them playing the national anthems inside the stadium. We were that close to missing the start of the game. And as I got to the kiosk, the person who got to the next kiosk heard what I was saying, asking for some tickets, and to my uttermost surprise, she turned to me as I was asking for two tickets. She said, "I've got two spare tickets. I'm returning mine. You can have mine." How much do I need? No money. Here's two tickets. You can have these. Well, there's a result. We're going to an international game, and I get two free tickets. That was all good until we realized, of course, that not only were we seated in the middle of the main stand, surrounded by Danish supporters. And I kid you not, I estimate that we were 50% of all the England supporters in the ground. And to make matters worse, as the game went on, Denmark were all over England. They deserved to win by several goals, except somehow the mighty Lionesses held out and scored in the last few seconds of the game to win the game 2-1. Get in there. I'm thinking, I quite like this England team and I quite like this football that I'm seeing for free, and we win. But there was more to come. At the final whistle, as everyone got up to go, I detected that the Danish team were going to do something. I wasn't quite sure what it was. They'd huddled in the middle, and then they all came walking over to the stand where we were. And I said to Jill, look, we need to just wait for a minute to see what was going to happen. And sure enough, the Danish team began to kick quality leather footballs into the crowd to express their gratitude to us Danes for supporting them. Now, as a representative of England, I thought it would be very rude if I didn't receive one of these balls. You know, I'm not very tall. And I had to fight off all these little eight-year-old girls as I jumped rugby line out style to catch one of these quality footballs. And having caught one, a second ball bounced along the row where I was resting after my exertion, and I was able to give one ball away. You see why Jill and I were hooked on women's football? Free ticket, victory, and to boot, a leather football. I like this game. With hindsight, it was a picture to me of the blessings of Christ, which was read to us earlier in the meeting from Ephesians chapter 1. Initially, Paul, talking to the nation of Israel, he says, he has blessed us in the heavenly realms. He chose us. In love, he predestined us to be adopted through Jesus Christ. And he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. It's as if we're drawn to the ground for the game and discover that there's nothing to pay. You can't earn or even pay your entry into the match to this main event of life. It's a free gift to us. We simply have to receive the ticket. It's as if God wishes to lavish us with his blessings, to pour out his blessings upon us. Joy and victory. And on top of that, he wishes to give his greatest gift, his Holy Spirit, to each and every one of us. Verse 13 of that chapter 1 of Ephesians. You also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is our deposit, guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. It's as if he says this, here's my gift to you, my promised Holy Spirit as counselor and guide, with all the potential of the emerging fruits of his Spirit, accompanied by spiritual gifts. And with open arms, we receive all that he wishes to give to us in order that the lives of us all, but your life especially, whoever you are, will resonate, will ring with God's presence, shine with his glory, marked with his divine love, effectively all of us being commissioned as messengers of God's compassion to a world that seems increasingly bereft of it. Daring to be different? How? By living like Christ, the supreme example. By continuing to ask the Spirit to come, the supreme power that enables us to become like him, to be transformed within us, reflecting and radiating his glory and the compassion of Jesus himself. who at the commencement of his season of ministry, when he returned to Nazareth on the Sabbath and he went to the synagogue, as was his custom, and he was given the scroll of Isaiah, which he opened and he read. Many of you will remember, "The Spirit of the Lord," he said, "is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." It's hardly surprising then that throughout his ministry, time and time again, he was moved with compassion to make a difference in the lives of all people, but especially the broken, the despised, the sick, the lepers, the adulterers, the criminals, the children, the hungry, the bereaved, the people who were on the complete margins, the ostracized, the friendless, the unloved, and the poor. With compassion, he entered their worlds and was with them. He led them to wholeness as a consequence of the intentional close relationships that he forged with them. We sang earlier, everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. We all need his compassion, his withness, if you like, him joining us. Yes, especially in our suffering, for that's what compassion truly means, being with us in these moments. But Salvation Army, hear this. Church of Christ, hear this. He doesn't say to the refugee, to the victim of modern slavery and of trafficking, he doesn't say to the homeless, the lost, the poor, the lonely, the children, go and find the local core and go and find the local church. He says to us, as individuals, and he says to us in our local core and in our local churches, go, live, and love, and give yourselves in compassion. Go. Go give the hungry food, the thirsty something to drink. Give hospitality to the stranger and the refugee. Clothe the naked. Look after the sick. Care for the prisoner. And he says, when you do that, you'll find me right there. For whatever you did for the least of these, my brothers and sisters of mine, you actually did for me. I share testimony to the truth of these words, please, not to draw attention to me, but to point you to Jesus. Jill and I were on our way home one evening from an event. We had a bit of a drive home, and so we needed to stop and get some drink and some crisps and some chocolate just to sustain us on our long journey home. And we stopped at a local corner shop in a city some 100 miles or more away from here. We went into the local corner shop rather than a supermarket, and having gathered what I needed to sustain us for the journey, I got to the till, but in front of me, in the queue for the till, was a young woman, a young mum, probably in her late 20s, early 30s, but her gaunt, thin figure and piercing eyes gave me the impression that this was a woman with some issues that was compounded, that in her arms was a crying, screaming toddler. In her basket, all that she had was some bread and some eggs and some milk. And when she came to pay, the few coins that she had in her hand clearly were not going to be enough. And the shopkeeper explained to her quite harshly that she would need to put back one of the three items. And it was clear to me that the mum was distressed by this as she turned to take something back. And I did what all of us in this gathering would have done and said. I simply said to her, please let me pay for these for you. And her response hit me. Her tearful eyes looked up at me and she simply said to me, God bless you. And to my astonishment, he did. Unexpectedly, powerfully, throughout my whole body, as if Jesus himself had spoken to me. Whatever you do for the least of these, my brothers, you do unto me. And it's increasingly that on the edges that we find Jesus himself present. You know, it's strange, but it's significant to me. I'm sure you've, lieutenants, I'm sure you've worked this one out, but it's strange but significant that the first seven letters of the word compassion spell compass. No? Where have you been for the last 2 years? The first seven letters spell compass. And I think it's time that we all need to check our compass bearings. That we check that we are aligned not to the true north, this is the old geography teacher speaking, not to true north, but to Christ himself, who described himself not only as the truth, but also as the life, and significantly as the way. We need to know that we are following his direction, that our compass bearing is in line with him. A compass bearing which always begins with his repeated invitation to come to me. Come, follow me, he says. Come my way. Come to me, all you are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. You have life in all its fullness. And as I thought about this compass bearing, I came back in my thoughts to the football that I caught. Yes, it spoke to me about gifts, and it spoke to me about blessings, and it spoke to me about joy. But as I reflect now, the kicking of the footballs into the crowd from a bunch of footballers now says something significant to me. It says, don't just be a spectator. Sat up there in the grandstands watching the game. But the kicking of the football into the crowd says, here's a football, come and join the game. Get involved. Be part of the journey. Come and engage. Dare to be different. Dare to boldly go. Be part of this story of the compassion of God. We're all needed, you see, every one of us on the field of play, active, not just spectators and commentators. I'll be honest with you, I toyed briefly with the idea of kicking some footballs into the congregation, but I didn't have the time or the heart to do the risk assessment. But you will know if there's something that you should be catching at this point. It may be for you personally, you have to catch the ball and join the game. Something has stirred within you that you can only put down to God in Christ speaking to you personally and by name, calling you to enter into a life-challenging encounter with Jesus, who offers you grace, forgiveness, redemption, freedom, and the gift of his Holy Spirit. You need to become a sincere follower of Jesus. You need to catch this ball and walk his way. Or it could be that you've been around a while and you know Christ, but deep within you, you know things need to be different. You need to be different. For you, it's no longer comfortable to be resting in the truth that the Salvation Army and the wider church is involved in the physical expressions of compassion to the victims of human trafficking or of housing and settling refugees from Syria or Afghanistan. For you, you're not content any longer knowing that the church, the Salvation Army, is at the forefront of work with lonely and elderly or young people without homes. No, the ball is thrown into your court, as it were, for you personally, to stand up, not on the back of the Salvation Army, but for you personally, to make a difference in the community in which you live and have your being, stepping forward, you now. Keep us from just singing, move us into action, we must go. Whatever that might mean for you in your world or in your town or in your community or your university or wherever it happens to be that you have your being. And for some of you, you need to step up to the plate to make yourself available for leadership within the Salvation Army. To put everything down in order that you can catch the ball that is coming your way. It's time. And others of us, well, maybe we just took our eyes off the ball. We dropped the ball we once held. And it's time. Or perhaps we've been juggling too many balls. It's time to realign, time to come again and offer our lives and receive His blessing and His anointing on our lives in freshness as we intentionally seek to live out the Jesus life, His life and message of compassion, which moves us into action. I will offer up my life in spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to you. In surrender, I must give you my every part. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, so loving a King, Savior? What can be said, what can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words could not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart. We're going to sing those words. And as we sing those words, did you sense the ball coming to you? Realize that God calls us to respond to the free gifts that He offers to you and I in Jesus Christ by His Holy Spirit. And as is our beautiful custom in the army, a place of prayer for you to come and stand, to sit, to kneel, to literally live out these words is a moment for us to respond. I will offer up my life in spirit and in truth. I surrender. I give every part. Lord, please receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. As we sing, I invite you to come forward as we make our prayers and our commitments before the Lord just now. Thank you.
Surrender, I must give my every part.
just moving amongst us. His presence, tangible, touching us, calling us, drawing us. And I know for some, perhaps, who may have been in the Salvation Army meeting for the very first time, it might seem very strange, but my word, we're on holy ground as God, by His Spirit, moves. We simply make our responses to Him. What can I possibly bring to Him? Well, I bring the sacrifice of my heart, of my life to Him. Come on. This is time for us to do business with Him. We don't have to think about this for too much, for too long, to make our responses to Him if you know that He's speaking to you. Let's do it. Let's make ourselves available as we sing. I will offer up my life. Hallelujah. Come and join the game. Be engaged. Make a difference by offering your life to Him. Boldly going, the staff band introduced in our thinking that beautiful song, If Crosses Come, if it should cost me dearly to be the servant of my servant Lord, if darkness falls around the path of duty and men despise the Saviour I've adored, I'll not turn back. And I'm going to suggest that we sing those words just now. And for some of us, it would be a spur for us, not about going back, but about going forward, and about us embracing that which is opening up for us, the revelation of God for us, the light that is shining on our path, to take just that one step forward with him in order that we might align ourselves with the compass bearing of the way, the truth, and the life. And young people especially, I just want to say to you, if you consider yourself to be a young person, you know, the blessings of God are available for us now. You don't have to wait until you're 20 or 30 or 40 or much. You can receive as a child the blessing of God in fullness now. And I want you to hear and know the testimony of many of us that God speaks to us as youngsters. In being obedient to him now, a whole lifetime of service. I just put that into your thought and mind. I know it's a long way to come down from upstairs, but please, don't let this moment move past us. If God has been speaking to you and you found a ball landing in your court, if cross has come, if it should cost me dearly. there. I wonder if there's someone who would just bravely say a prayer for our brothers and sisters as they kneel before the Lord, and for others who have been here and others who may yet still to come. Is there someone who would pray?
Father, we thank you that you are a God of boundless compassion, and that whatever needs our friends kneel before you with this evening,
beautiful brokenness,
we are more than able to meet those needs out of your abundant riches in Christ Jesus. Father, we thank you for the movement of your Spirit in our midst today. If we ever needed you, we need you now.
Yes.
Our fractured, divided world needs the compassion of Christ. And as we've been reminded this evening, that compassion needs to be seen in us as individuals. Unless we are moved by compassion, then Christ is not in the world. And so we thank you, Father. We thank you for this evidence this evening that you are very much in the world, that you are in our midst, that you are bringing healing and hope and direction to those who kneel before you this evening, and that you are meeting their needs. And Father, we pray for others who are on the edge of their seat, who have caught a ball this evening, but have tucked it under their seat. We pray, Father, that they would have the courage to dare to be different, to live like Christ, and that before this day is out, they will come and kneel and bring themselves to you. Father, we commit the new lieutenants into your care, and those who have knelt before you this evening into your care. And we remind those that dwell in the spiritual realms that we are absolutely persuaded that you are able to keep that which we have committed until Christ comes in glory. And we make this prayer, Father, expecting an answer, anticipating an answer, and thanking you for the answers that are still to come, in the powerful name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Beauty for brokenness, hope for despair. Lord, in your suffering world, this is our prayer. I invite you to stand as we sing these words, and as we own these words, understand the call for each of us to be messengers of compassion. Thank you.
To sun.
Father, we simply say, may that prayer be answered in us, for your sake and for the world's sake. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to be blessed now as we come to the conclusion, the finale of this great day together, my lighthouse dance. And, well, I'm going to sit down before they think I'm going to dance.
We're really privileged that the children are going to come and lead us as we continue in our worship together. However, I think that they would really like it if you joined in with them. So if you're able, let's stand. We're going to sing My Lighthouse together. You can copy their dance moves if you want to, but, you know, it's up to you.
In my failures, oh, what God.
That was awesome! Yay! Thank you. On behalf of each lieutenant of the Messengers of Compassion session, I would like to thank each of you for supporting us today, for your prayers and for your good wishes. We're grateful for each and every way that you have been part of our journeys to this point. Thank you. As we sing our final songs, each lieutenant will approach the foot of the cross and take a heart. The hearts signify the compassion of Christ towards us. And as we each take a heart from the cross, we are showing our readiness to boldly go, to take that compassion out to those we meet, wherever we meet them, particularly to those communities to which we have been appointed. At the close of the meeting, there will be people on hand to distribute these heart mementos to you too. Maybe you'd like to take one, and it will be a memory for you of today's commissioning. Maybe you'd like to take one, and it will remind you of the love of Jesus Christ for you. Maybe you'd like to take one and give it to someone you know who needs to know the love of Jesus Christ today. Go on, be bold. Please stand and sing with us, God of Justice, We Must Go.
Thank you.
Some final words from Ephesians chapter 3. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Good night, and God bless you, each and every one.
I cut it out.